Pittsburgh, Ohio. So just letting you know that the camera is on. So there you go.
It's mood lighting here at City Hall this evening.
Just to ensure that everyone can hear you and loud on Facebook, if you can just talk really clearly and loud into the mic so that way if it's picked up,
The closer
you need to speak tonight, if you could come down and sign in.
Just like name page numbers, just like the people that have everything in the agenda at home, you can say.
What is that?
Oh, you go to the page number.
Yeah.
Because my phone's not going to be able to pick up the clarity up there. I'm not more than 4-6 on the.
They should be able to. We'll say what application they're on.
Yeah. Say page number.
I don't know if you must say.
Get some of it.
Get some of it, probably.
Yeah.
This is the end. This is the because it's got as much as we can, so we're good.
go ahead and call the September 3rd, 2020 meeting of the Reynoldsburg Board of Zoning and Building Appeals to order. We have the roll call, please.
Ms. Barnhart?
Here.
Here.
Ms. Bowles?
Here.
Mr. Hurst?
Here.
Pastor Linder?
Here.
Mr. Repke?
Here. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes for the regular meeting on August 20th, 2020? Hearing none, we'll mark those as approved. Any additions or changes to the agenda as presented? Hearing none, we'll approve the agenda. Anybody wishing to speak before the board tonight, would you please stand? We'll swear you in. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. You may be seated. Item two, any public comment? Is there any public that would wish to comment? Seeing none, we'll move on to item three, unfinished business. Any unfinished business to come before the board? Having none, we'll move on to item four, new business. Can we please have a presentation of application 2020-5344, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The first agenda item this evening is for the property at 1950 to 1952 Baltimore-Reynoldsburg Road. As mentioned, the application number is 2020-5344. And the applicant is requesting Board of Zoning and Building Appeals approval of a conditional use to operate a child daycare center. The center will provide service for approximately 25 to 50 children. The property is within the community commercial zone in which child daycare center is listed as a conditional use. BZBA approval at the discretion of the zoning administrator is the request of this evening. And with that, I believe the applicant is present and may have some additional information to provide. They have provided a statement as well of detailing the proposed business as well as answering the conditional use factors in section 11.9.15.
Would the applicant please come forward, or the parties representing the applicant? Was everything accurate that Ms. Wheeler had to present? Is there anything additional that you'd like to add?
I've been doing child care for 21 years, since 1999, and due to COVID and the children not attending school, I need to expand for more room. And this building that we and my staff found, it's ready to go. I just need to be approved to start the business. And
oh, you're doing good so far. Are there any witnesses or anybody presenting testimony in support or opposition of the application? I forgot one thing. Can you state your name and address?
My name is Shaquista Patrick.
If you could just make sure you're speaking loudly into the microphone, so that sometimes it's
yeah,
muffled.
It's a little hard for me to hear.
Okay, Shaquista Patrick, owner and operator of Miss E's Learning Playhouse.
And did you ladies want to speak? You can state your name and the address for the record.
Yes, it's Jean Cabral, 2939 Bexley Park Road, Columbus. I'm an architect, and Shaquista has asked me to work with her on daycare. It's very well suited for a daycare already. The space was office, but it's got large rooms. It's handicap accessible. And also the nice thing about the site is that you enter from the northeast off a back road, a service road. So kids are going to be coming in and out the front door going on the 56. So it's going to be a lot safer as far as that entrance. There we go. So they can either go, I pulled it down a little bit. There's some side access roads between the other buildings. They go to a back access road that will enter from the east side of the property. So the kids will be right in the corner. From a safety point of view, it's very good. There's plenty of exits. It's in very good condition, so that's also a plus too. And there's a lot of businesses around there. I know a lot of times people, I do a lot of daycares, people like to have the kids near them when they're working. So hopefully the people that are working in the area or living in the area, they'll come and drop their kids off in the morning and go to work. That's about all I have to say.
Just for the record, would you point out exactly what section that you would be taking the...
Those two storefronts, the two storefronts to the left with the bed awnings.
Thank you.
So that's closest to...
Discount.
Tire discounters?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's grass and median in between and sidewalk.
What did that... Anybody remember what that used to be?
A lot.
What was that?
Century 21.
Century 21. Yeah. Thank you. You can state your name and address, please.
Yes, good evening. My name is Kathy Woods, and I'm an employee of Mrs. Patrick. I'm also her mother, and I'm very excited for this venture. As she has stated before, she has been doing this since 1999, and I've been working alongside her. Rest but kind of like coming in when she needs someone to tend to the children while she takes care of business. So I'm excited about the extension. And I hope that Reynoldsburg would be more than willing to give us this opportunity to help in this dire need with the COVID-19 going on. Thank you.
You guys have anything you'd like to ask, Mr. Hurst?
Yeah, I do, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. So I do appreciate that you're addressing a dire need here with additional child care during the COVID-19 crisis. There are just, as you've indicated, you know, some pros and some cons with this particular location. One of the things that immediately pops out to me is, you know, you typically see some sort of play space and daycare facilities. Were you planning to have some sort of outdoor play space or anything like that here?
Yes, sir. I don't know if it's on that piece of paper, but if you can see, as you exit out of 1950, it's the exit door that's in the, that is outside of the parking lot. Right there by that car to the left. It's a big square space.
In between the two buildings, is that what you mean?
No, it's right on the sidewalk.
Okay.
So
I wouldn't say how many.
Is it that green space there that's below the building? That kind of that.
It's when you
the walk, concrete. It's the rectangle right there.
Yes. Sir.
Okay.
It's
gotcha.
The concrete right when you walk out. The architect advised me that it would be a good area for a play area. I would just have to install a fence area. But speaking with my landlord, he was even offering to extend another side for a play area just for the inside. Because if I have a play area on the inside of the facility, I don't have to have a play area on that side. And also, we are located where the location is a park. When you run the daycare care facility, you can transport the children to a park for outside play.
So did you have an intent to do that if you didn't put an outdoor play space in, or?
I was thinking of putting an outside play space right there on the ceiling right there. And it's next to, it's right outside the front door, to the right of the building.
and his bushes and grass. Yes, I plan on doing it if I don't get a play area. But I also have the option of the playground close by for the children.
Board members, would there be any objection with us, if we did want to approve this tonight, that in a condition that specifies the location of the play space, and that the applicant would have to take children to an adjacent park if that was not constructed?
Ms. Patrick, my name is Chris Shuck. I'm the city attorney for Reynoldsburg. One of the unique things about a conditional use application for a child care center is that there are some additional requirements. One of those that actually addresses play areas themselves. So one of those requirements is that no play area shall be located adjacent to a loading space, loading dock, or other area where vehicles are likely to idle. Do you believe that your proposed space for the play area will be in one of those locations that is prohibited? In addition, it also indicates that no play area shall be constructed in a manner that allows children access to any electrical or telecommunications box or vault. Are you aware of any concerns of that in the location where you intend to put your play area?
There's no
electric poles.
There's no poles or electric.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, I just want to make sure we address those.
Thank you.
This is Mr. Recky. The play area next to that parking lot is where it becomes problematic, I think, with what Mr. Shook let out. But.
Yeah, I think that the only potential concern there is how we define loading space or an area where vehicles are likely to idle. So if we're looking at this particular location, you're probably going to see children being dropped off, and in that scenario, a lot of parents are likely to leave their cars running, potentially leave their cars running during a time period in which they're dropping their kids off. So that might be a concern going forward. It's not an outright prohibition to granting the conditional use permit because she's not required to have the play area itself, but it could be a problem with the play area.
Yeah, we run into this a bunch of times with strip malls and try to find a location for play areas that's acceptable and have enough security with a car coming through that parking lot where you would have either a ballast or bollard type guardrail, basically something more than a chain link fence. So.
I had a comment about that. The two spaces that are on either side of that concrete area, I could do the parking calculations and see if it's a little over parked. If it is, we could possibly turn those into striped areas, no parking. That's one thing. The other is that if we do plan on putting a fence around it, it could be opaque or not opaque. Also, we could pull that fence back from the edge of the concrete so it's not right on the edge. I think if we could work those things out and the site approval process, I don't know if it's overparked or not, to be honest with you, but I can figure that out. And also, too, there is some grassy area to the left of the building. Not very big, but again, all you want to do is take three or four kids, five kids out at one time. It doesn't have to be a very large play area. So we can certainly adjust that. Also, too, the parents are not allowed to, I suppose they could leave their car idling, but they have to walk their children in. So unless they want to get possibly get their car stolen, I don't think they're going to leave the keys in the car. So she could also make that a condition of taking the children. If that ever happens, the kids go. If a parent does something like that as well. So there are some ways to do that.
I think from my perspective, just taking a look at this, certainly the grass area, as it's pushed back from the parking lot a little bit more, is certainly going to be a little bit safer. It's going to get it out of that sort of that smog zone so much. Or Even better if you, as you had mentioned previously, having more of that indoor location, and not that we would want the children to cross 256, but certainly you're in pretty close proximity of one of the largest metro parks. I would feel better knowing that the children would have a safer experience being able to be located and having an outdoor play area, utilizing the parks that are already there, instead of sort of trying to squeeze in maybe an outdoor space where it doesn't necessarily fit. But I guess we make that call. It kind of depends on where you guys are leaning, where we should take our action, for the board, or what they'd like to see.
I personally think maybe a small outside play area for just a few children at a time. So it's not a center that's going to have a lot of kids in it at one time. Maybe a little on the grass, a little on the concrete, but pull it away from that parking place. Also, too, when the kids go to an outdoor park, they get driven there. They don't walk. So
sure,
they're not going to be walking across 256. But there's certainly a way that you could take maybe only half of that concrete area, combine it with some of the grass, and get a little bit of both. And pull it away from the parking places. And again, I'll investigate how many, if I went over, hopefully, one or two over, that would be all to the benefit of the play area too.
What is the maximum number of children that you expect to serve at this daycare center?
As far as, it's one for 60 square feet in a play area for indoor.
Can I ask a question? The grassy area, I'm trying to look at the one outline of the lot. I don't know that the grassy area is a part of that lot to go with that building. I think it might go to the discount player.
There's a little bit.
There's a little bit.
This strip here that's not so close.
It's relative. I draw these lines, so they're not exactly.
Yeah. Certainly, you would have to work with them to make sure if you were to put in that fence.
So, for a little clarification, we're here for the conditional use permit. We're not quite sure about the playground. How would that playground be permitted or approved? Would that go through the city then? Or?
Yes. If the board was inclined to grant the conditional use permit, you could put on a condition that any outdoor play area comply with section 1105.13 subsection G, which are the requirements we laid out for where a play area can be located.
And what was that section again?
That's section 1105.13 subsection G.
Subsection what?
G, sorry.
Well, I have an ear problem right now, so that doesn't help either. Any other discussion from the board? Questions, concerns, comments?
Two other things I would note, just for purposes of the record, that based upon the site location, this request is not located within 150 feet of a gasoline station, which is a prerequisite for a child care center. And additionally, the application indicates that the hours of operation are between 6 a.m. and 6 p.m., which are permitted hours under the child care center conditional use application factors.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a couple things. That's right.
Yeah.
It does say between 35 and 50 children. You know right now what you're expecting to begin with? Will you start with the 35? And then if you could, what do you think the age breakout will be as far as how many of those are in that infant category?
Well, right now, at this present time, I have 13 children enrolled or on my roster. Usually at the end of August, my school-agers go back to school. So some of my parents are on unemployment, some of my parents are scared to go back to work, and some of my parents still need child care. So the 13 will transfer and come with me. And another reason why I'm expanding is because two of my parents are pregnant. So I'm gonna start off, it'll take a while for, you know, the building, fire, building inspection, fire inspection, and all the other inspections. I would like to open up in beginning of November. It's 1 to 5, the ratio for infants is 1 to 5, but the bulk of the children will be preschool and school age, school agers. So while they're virtual learning, I plan to set up the areas for those children to have their Chromebooks and be in attendance of school while their parents are at work. And I've set 25 or 30 to 50 or something like that. I really don't know. I really won't find out how many children I'm allowed to have until Ohio Department of Job and Family Services comes out and does their final walkthrough after all the inspections are finished. Then they will let me know how many children I could have in each room.
Thank you. And just a comment, Mr. Chairman, I do agree that this situation with the playground should be addressed in the way of an amendment, or personally, if we move forward, that would be something important to me. Thank you.
Any other questions, concerns, comments?
I do have one. I know you mentioned the 60 children per square footage. What is the total square footage that you'll be leasing inside the building? I didn't read it in the packet, so that's why I'm asking.
It's about 2,400 to 2,500 square feet.
Okay.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, thank you. For the record, 24 to 2,500 is what was said.
When I first take on a project, I kind of figure by a rule of thumb, divide by 150, and that gives you the maximum number of kids you'll probably be able to have. It's usually less than that. Once you take what you factor out, the bathrooms and the hallways and the offices and things like that. So realistically, she'd probably be maxed out at 40 to 42 children. And certainly no more than that, because we have to factor in the number of teachers. And also too, smoke alarms and all kinds of things kick in when you get to 50. So we want to stay 49 or less for everybody, including adults. But that would take, I think it'll take a little while. Most of my clients take a year or two to kind of build up. And then things always start shifting. Kids go to school, new kids, parents come. There's always kind of a shift of ages over a period of time.
Now, you had mentioned the indoor playground. Would that be an additional unit?
Yes.
Okay. So you'd have to come get conditional approval on that, correct?
Yes, sir.
No, this would just be an extension of the already existing conditional use. You're not granting the conditional use based on the square footage. I just asked that. So if they were expanding their business, it would still be an allowed conditional use. So it would just be them leasing more space per contract with whoever the landlord is.
I would agree with Mr. Boucher's assessment.
Mr. Shook, if we were to add a condition to this that the playground, if it was going to be outdoors, be constructed in such a manner that complied with all necessary regulations, is that something that your office of the city administration would be comfortable with them approving if we made it conditional in that sense?
I would be comfortable with that. In addition, I would note that on conditional use applications that are granted, there are periodic checks that the planning and zoning administrator has to engage in to ensure that the applicant is operating within the conditional use that was granted.
Okay.
And certainly with the build out of this, they will have to submit building plans as well as that outdoor space. So there'll be several other checks, as Mr. Shook had mentioned, that will be following along throughout their process before they open.
Any other concerns, comments? Anything the applicant or architect would like to summarize?
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
I do agree with Mr. or Pastor Linder that we should condition that on the playground. Anybody have an objection to that? Hearing none, would the applicant be fine with that condition being placed upon the approval?
Yeah, I would just make the condition clear with whichever member is going to make the motion. Just reference section 11.5.13G.
Mr. Chairman, if you would, I'd like to make a motion.
Okay.
I move that we accept this conditional use application with the following conditions. That any outdoor play facility that is in use at the site conform to any necessary regulations as required by law, specifically section 11.05.13G. And if such outdoor facilities is not provided, that an indoor facility is provided or the children are shuttled to a adjacent park.
I'd like to second that.
Thank you, Pastor Linder. Moved and seconded. Any further discussion or deliberation? Hearing none, can you please have a roll call for the vote, please?
Ms. Barnhart?
Yes.
Ms. Bowles?
Yes.
Mr. First?
Yes.
Pastor Linder?
Yes.
And Mr. Redke?
Yes. Congratulations. This is the first step, though. Mr. Bowdo, anything to add to that before they leave?
I do not. Welcome to Reynoldsburg.
Thank you so much.
Okay, moving on, item under new business, item 2, application 2020-5372. Can we please have a presentation?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The second agenda item this evening is for the property located at 8617 Taylor Road Southwest. This is approximately a 15.2-acre site within the suburban residential zone. The applicant is requesting BZBA approval of a conditional use for the construction of a new residential development consisting of 128 townhome units with a central clubhouse. The proposal does include a mix of 98 two-bedroom and 3-bedroom units, and the development did receive major site plan approval at the August 27th Special Planning Commission meeting. No variances were required or requested for the project. As mentioned, the proposed use, which is dwelling attached single family, is listed as a conditional use within the SR zone, and BZBA approval is requested for this proposed development. With that, I know the applicant is present as well, and we do have the site plan up on the screen that was approved by the Planning Commission.
If we could just swear in the applicants before they speak as well. Thank you. Yes, please. Mr. First, while we
while we wait, would you mind going over the any conditional uses that may have been placed upon planning commission as you do serve as on that board as well, just so it is on the record for the BZBA members?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Bratcher. If I do recall correctly, we did request that the property boundary, the plantings there, whatever sort of bounding was going to exist, be kind of buttressed, and to increase the little bit of separation between the existing homes that are adjacent to the property. And we did ask for a trash compactor to be moved, and if the applicant could maybe speak to how they've addressed those requests, I'd appreciate it.
We'll go swear you in first, so if you please rise. You solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
I do. Thank you, sir. If you could state your name and address for the record, please.
Yeah, I'm Chris Brzezzi with Burrard Partners Architects. We're at 1398. We do the whole order. Columbus, Ohio.
I'm Larry Mathery, 5285 Gender Road, Canal, Winchester, Ohio.
Was the information regarding the application and notice accurate, or any changes you'd like to express?
The three conditions that were at the planning commission, I don't recall them being tracked.
No, my mistake.
I think it was additional fencing at the boundary that was providing driveway access to the adjacent neighbor.
Would you mind speaking on that, sir?
The second was providing, maintaining driveway access for the adjacent single family residence, which is now currently going through the property. The first one was increasing the buffer planting standards along the adjacent property. I'm trying to remember the third one, but it's escaping me. Andrew, do you recall?
I think it was us working together to fix any unresolved water quality, stormwater issues, obviously with the ponds. It was just working with us through the PGU process, site sale process after these approvals. And I think Mr. First was mentioning, I think you guys came and said you were changing the location of the trash compactor from what was originally on the drawings, if I'm not mistaken.
I remember one of the residents voicing concerns about the compactor.
Okay, maybe
that's
what was going on.
I don't recall any specific discussion about the location.
Sure. Emily, can you go back to site plan, please? Thank you.
Yeah, currently the trash compactor is located adjacent to building 4, I believe that number is. East.
It's in between building 4 and the parking lot, the little parking space.
And what was the access issue with the adjoining owner?
And like using that. Perhaps. Is there an existing overlay plan? The notch in the center of the project to the north, you see the dashed structure. That's an existing single family residence. Currently, their driveway goes to the south through that easement.
And you can see it faintly outlined there. They have a bridge that crosses over a small little creek bed. It goes through and then out.
And then to Taylor Road along our south property line. So Larry is currently in the process of negotiating an agreement with that owner to install a new driveway, which would go to the north.
And run down that northerly property line?
Yes. The homeowner has a lot to the north there where you can use that property for the driveway access to Canada.
Cool. So as you can can see there, the house is still there. They'll be building the driveway to the north. That property owner also owns a parcel there that's adjacent to Canada Court. Obviously, that's a civil matter, but there was a condition made on there to ensure that they have normal access and a permanent access at the end of the project to be in place. So that does not need to be added as a condition. It was already done so by Planning Commission. Emily, would you mind running through some of the other slides? The architect had sent us over this afternoon some additional pictures and slides that wasn't in the original packet. Kind of just wanted to share some of those to highlight sort of the community and not necessarily just the units themselves.
So this is a view from Taylor Road looking to the east. And basically, I think we provided essentially three views from Taylor Road. As you can see from the scale and size of the proposed structures and the way they're articulated, they do have a very much residential scale. We think they fit in well with the adjacent neighborhoods, both in size, scale, and materiality. We also have trees lining Taylor Road, which will soften things up as well. This one's from the north on Taylor Road looking southeast. This view is from one of the neighbor's backyards to the south. Now, we did not model the new vegetation that would go in place. If we did, I don't think you would see much of our structures with 6-foot evergreens. But the intent here was to show, again, the residential character that we're proposing with these attached single-family structures. Just another angle from the south. The other feature we are incorporating, we have a mix of exterior designs incorporating both gable elements and shed roof elements together with four different color schemes. The exteriors will be a mix of vinyl siding and brick, as you can see here. So I think that plays well also with the adjoining neighbors. These last two slides are front views of the buildings themselves up close. I think this is depicting two of the four color schemes that we're proposing. And that's the gable scheme there.
Can you can staff elaborate on what the two different types of zonings are? You know, it's currently suburban residential, and what the essential difference is for the record.
Yes, so the suburban residential zoning allows for two sets of developments, one permitted, the other one conditional, when we're talking about single family homes. What would be approved without a condition would be single family detached. This is a single family attached product. These are mainly rental market rate. And so what you're seeing here is just attached single families. So tonight, we're not reviewing specifically the design or the site plan that was already done by Planning Commission. What you will be reviewing is the conditional approval to allow this use on this site and if it conforms to the area. In addition, just making sure that you're looking at the surrounding areas, the traffic impact, as well as the roadway, and if it fits in with the context of the suburban residential of this zone, as well as the neighborhood.
I would also just add to that the differentiating factor between an attached single family and something like a multi-unit development. The zoning code lists a definition for attached single family, which requires that each unit have independent exterior access, no less than two exterior walls. So that's, so the proposal here does meet that definition for attached single family.
Mr. Chairman, if you don't mind, I do have a few questions for the applicant.
So as you're no doubt aware, you know, traffic is always a concern when we see new development applications. You know, I know that you've attempted to address some of that by having two entrances. Perhaps you could elaborate a little bit on if there was anything specific to this site that made it more, preferential, you know, from a traffic standpoint versus, you know, maybe somewhere else in the city.
I know we've gone through our studies to show that this would fit inside the scope that is allowed in Reynoldsburg. As far as another location, I haven't looked at one. I can't say I have. As far as blending in, I know that the Taylor Road is already, I believe, three lanes. There's a center lane, so it does give the opportunity for the extra lane to come in and go out of the project, which pretty much, from my understanding, covered what we needed to cover for the amount of cars in this project. So, really, there's no other issues brought up.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. Thank you.
Pardon me? Oh, sorry. Oh, okay. I have a little problem here too.
So, one other question. I know there was some public comment about, and we're not reviewing this section of the proposal tonight, but I was just kind of curious to hear about, you know, why you chose to use a front-facing garage versus something like a rear-facing garage product.
Well, it's my experience in this type of product is what I normally build and use. It brings more of a family atmosphere to the area, you know, whether it's just the attached garage, it just gives it more of that home feeling instead of just a boxed unit with no garages. For us, we just get a little more income, nicer space, and we're able to bring in families to the community. A little easier to manage that way, too.
Sure. Thank you.
That's why we do it.
I know one of the concerns I've heard is the density. Can we speak to the permitted use? What would the approximate density be? If it was a single family home, suburban residential, what would the impact be versus the proposed impact? I know I'm putting you on the spot.
What? If you could clarify, maybe you're asking, are you asking what it would be if it was just single family detached?
Yes.
Versus this?
Yeah.
That's a very loaded question because that's an entirely different site plan with an entirely different layout, and that would be on a different building.
I can speak to the issue. In the suburban residential district, there is no maximum number of units per acre. Conversely, in the residential medium district, which is where attached single family and multi-unit facilities are permitted uses, the maximum density is 24 units an acre.
Yeah, but in a single family residential setting, you can only get so many lots and so many acres, correct?
The zoning code does not indicate that.
You don't have a minimum lot size?
We have minimum lot sizes, that's correct. We do not have, we have specific requirements regarding setbacks and building height that mitigate any potential risk of significant density in a suburban residential district, but we do not have a maximum unit requirement.
And that was kind of to my point of if we were to sketch something out and draw it, yeah, I mean, we could absolutely do that. But to give you a number, it would be off base and it would be totally different.
Yeah, no, what I was looking for was, you know, if you could say, hey, that was a subdivision, it'd be 65 homes, we're doubling it, or 75 or 85.
What's the acreage? It's 10. What is the total acreage?
It's 15.2.
Minus your right-of-ways. Your right-of-ways would be larger, your setbacks would be larger. I forget what the county would use.
I don't build homes, so I really don't have an answer for you. Single family.
So our current density is 8.2, I believe.
The site plan is 8.42 units per acre.
It was just a comparison that, you know, it's not overly burdened on what was permitted is what I was trying to get at. Or yes, is it overly burdened?
I think it's well within line of what the use is, and it's very comparable to this use in other areas of our city and of Central Ohio. A typical single family development, depending on the type of lot size, you can see anywhere between 2 to 6.5 units an acre. Single family detached, attached, obviously you're gonna have a little bit more.
And I do agree that, you know, as far as the character of the development and its use in the surrounding area, that it is a good fit. Specifically the mix of materials and construction types is, you know, appreciated there. I think the main concern that most people have when they hear of any multifamily type unit or attached is that it's just going to be a sea of the same thing.
Oh, no.
And you've certainly mitigated that with this proposal, so thank you.
It was something that I was looking at when you had sent that to us. You know, time and time again do we see product where maybe it's got something that looks really nice on the front and then they use subpar materials in the rear. And so I really appreciated that the architect drew up some of the back end type stuff. And if Emily, if you could go to that screen again, you can see that the quality materials actually go towards the back, which is great for the homeowners to the rear. This is not going to decrease their property values, and I think that it adds a really nice element that they're gonna use the materials across the board. Too many times we see just regular vinyl horizontal that gets put onto the back, and it looks cheap, and that's not what we're seeing here. So we appreciate that. It's 10 or 11.
Yeah, I was referencing our page numbers.
One more. There you go.
Have any witnesses in opposition or for any in opposition or support of the project wish to speak? Hearing none.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to ask a few more questions.
Okay.
To get into some more detail regarding the conditional use factor. So I'd ask the applicant a few questions. Here on specifically, we're talking about Taylor Road, and in discussion of the factor about whether this proposed use is in harmony and consistent with other existing uses in the area. Can you describe what those other existing uses are in that particular area?
Well, there's a lot of single homes directly across from this product, and I believe further to the north there is another apartment complex that is. Not similar. I haven't been in it. I'm not sure if they even have attached garages, but there is a mixed-use apartment, townhomes, single-family homes, and I believe something's being built new just to the south of us, a ranch style, I believe. I'm not sure, but so I believe it's a good mix and fits with what you're doing in the area. That's new, and this is 2 and 3 bedroom units.
And just north of this proposed development, as you indicated, there are some
Yeah, there's one that I know. I'm not sure the name, but it's not too far down the road there. Been there a while.
And that's also on the east side of Taylor Road, correct?
Yes.
This slide identifies the nearby all that in the developments. Actually, there are three or four of them.
There's one.
And that's the one to the west.
Specifically regarding Taylor Road itself, it looks like with your application, there was some indication of a traffic estimate. Is that an estimate or is that a traffic study?
I believe it's an estimate.
Is that just based on the number of units that you're proposing for this development?
Yes.
Okay. With respect to Taylor Road, you had already discussed this earlier, but I want to clarify the exit from this particular development on the Taylor Road is on the far north portion of the parcel.
Yeah, further north than it is south.
So farther away from Kingsley Drive.
Yes. There's a headlight, a turn signal there.
Okay. And the next major intersection that would be located near this development would be Taylor and Main. Is that right?
I believe so, yes. I believe Main is closer than Broad.
Okay. Can you estimate for me just the distance between this development and that major intersection, Taylor and Main?
I'd say at least a quarter of a mile. I just asked that.
It's almost approximately 4,200 feet, which is a little over 3/4 of a mile.
Thank you. Thanks, Andrew.
One other issue, just to make sure we address it. The forward-facing garage, at some point, did you in your project consider rear parking for these units?
We looked at the option to flip in the building, but it just, you have to add extra streets and cost, and it just made everything just a little bit tighter. And it didn't give the presentation we wanted out front either, because you'd be looking at the back of the actual building.
Okay. And also, going back to the site plan, just on the same issue. If for these particular townhomes you had put parking in the rear, those cars would be located in close proximity to the detached single family homes that are located, for example, on Kingsley. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, and that was not something that you wanted to do because of the impact it could have on those surrounding homes.
Right.
Is that right?
I think, you know, if you put the buildings as a buffer to that, you know, as far as traffic. And there is a nice, I mean, there's a nice tree line that goes across that area now where the neighbors were concerned. So, I mean, we're going to dress it up and make sure that they got what they want.
One other thing I just thought about, and I just want to make sure we put this on the record. There is, of course, there's a home right there kind of in the center right to the north portion of this parcel, correct?
Yes.
Okay, and that's owned by a resident?
Correct.
And currently, as we know, there's an easement that resident has that allows them to drive out from that property onto Taylor Road.
Correct.
And you consider the impact of this development on that particular property, is that right?
Yes, and we're working on his access to the north.
Okay. You talked to that resident?
Yeah, I spoke with him today, in fact. So we're getting closer to getting an agreement. And then we can put a permanent driveway for him to leave this home and not go through this project. We hope to have it in place before we start.
Okay. And if you were able to reach that agreement with that particular resident, has that resident indicated any objection to this project?
Not that I've, no.
Thank you. I think that's all the questions I had.
Did anyone from the city check on that easterly exit?
Yes, we did. We were actually working with your engineer and in Planning Commission, we made note of this. That exit is not a through exit. That will be a permeable surface that butts to that dead end, that jet out. And it will have breakaway bollards for the fire department to use for emergency access only. It will not be able to be accessed from the residents of this community or of the community that is to the east. And there it outlines the difference in material and the ballards being there. We were working with our engineer on a standard drawing, and we'll continue to do so as we get into the site civil phase to make sure that it works in compliance with all necessary fire departments, specifically Southwest Licking, who would oversee this.
Any other comments, concerns, questions?
So based off of that, there would only be one entrance and one exit if you cannot exit out the east. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
And there's no restrictions on the subdivision plat to that side, that east side, limiting access unless it's extended by plat or deed.
Correct. And this was something that the neighbors were pressing on, but they certainly did not want that through access.
Yeah.
And these neighbors, this new community, wouldn't want through access as well.
Yeah, usually on those they say no access unless extended by plat or deed most of the time. So.
And this is not uncommon. The last two developments of a similar size, the Redwood product on Lancaster, as well as the product that the applicant had mentioned previously on Taylor Drive, had something very similar to this. Both had emergency access points only, as a second full access is not required.
Any other questions, concerns? Any additional exhibits? We've kind of already went over that. Anything you'd like to conclude?
No, I just appreciate your time. You know, we're going to try to build the nicest product we can inside Reynoldsburg. It keeps everybody happy. You know, we had a product in Canal Winchester we managed. We will manage this property ourselves, the family owned. So we kind of keep tight wraps on everything just to make sure it's, you know, what the community expects of the development of this site.
Any further consideration by the board or discussion?
Come on, guys, don't make me make all the motions.
That's nice. That's good. I'm hearing none. I'll move for approval. I lost my agenda. Sorry. Move for approval of application 2020-5372.
Is Mr. First a second?
Moved and seconded. Can we have the vote, please? Or is there any other discussion? Moved and seconded. Can we please have the vote?
Ms. Farner?
No.
Ms. Bowles?
Yes.
Mr. First?
Yes.
Pastor Linder?
Yes.
Mr. Repke?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Hey, Joe.
Thank you. I don't think there's anything else to cover, so moving on to other business. Any other business to come before the board? Having none, I guess we'll move to adjournment at 7 p.m. exactly. Thank you, guys.
We are going to have a meeting on the 17th. We have one application for that, just so you guys are aware. Typically, we've been doing a 6:30 time frame. However, we also have to have a planning commission meeting. That is it okay with everyone here that we do the BZA meeting at 6 on the 17th as well. That was the regular scheduled meeting, it's not a special meeting for BZA. Does it mean, we're in for 6 o'clock, yeah.
I'm out of town, but I think I've already mentioned that, I'm away that day, so.
To make sure that we have a quorum and everyone's okay with that, or we can adjust the time.
That time of day works for me.
Okay. Moving forward, both for planning commission and BZA, we'll be having them back live like this, moving forward through the remainder of the year, and I wanna make sure that that's not a hindrance or a problem with anybody.
6:30 works a little better for me.
We will adjust that back on this other one, it just happens to have a planning commission meeting at the same time, and we wanna make sure we have time for the evening for both. That's good, okay, thank you guys.
Mr. Mayor on the boom mic. That's powerful right there.